Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's HLAA Showcase webinar, the FDA regulations for over-the-counter OTC hearing aids with Dr. Thomas Powers. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Melissa Cruz. I'm with HLAA and I will be your host today. I'm going to start by giving you some tech tips. So the first one is to see captions on the webinar. You'll need to click the CC icon and click on Show Subtitles. You can change the font size in the subtitles settings. And the chat feature is available for technical issues and panelists only. We'd like participants to please use the Q&A icon to ask questions. We'll be using this to facilitate questions and answers after the presentation. If you've joined by computer, your presentation should be in the side-by-side mode. This will allow your slides to be on the left and the panelists on the right in a gallery view. You can change the size of your slide by hovering between the two screens and moving the gray bar to adjust your desired size. If you've joined us by mobile device or phone, your view may be slightly different and you may have to scroll between the views to get to the desired one. This is a disclaimer that HLAA does not endorse any products featured in the webinar. HLAA is providing an educational opportunity to learn about new products and opportunities and how they could benefit people with hearing loss. As I mentioned, our presenter today is Dr. Thomas Powers. Dr. Powers, I'm going to turn over the presentation to you.
Okay, hopefully, thank you very much, Melissa, and thanks everyone for joining us today. Hopefully you can see the screen. Is that, are we good there, Melissa? Yeah. I know I can see it. But, again, thanks to everybody for joining. What we're going to do today is take a little bit of a run through, as we said, the FDA, but first, just by way of introduction, a little background where I came from, and I call my journey sort of journey in audiology. Going the wrong way here. I started off in Geneseo, which is in upstate New York. I grew up there in Schenectady and went my undergrad there. Took my first job in the public schools doing speech therapy, which for some people, including me, convinced me that I should go back and move into audiology, although speech was very interesting for those couple of years. Got my master's and PhD at Ohio University in Little Athens, Ohio. My PhD work was mostly in electrophysiology, working with chinchillas. So when I moved on from there into private practice, seeing patients, they're a little different than chinchillas, but it was really the right turn that really started, I say, the rest of my career in audiology, in hearing aids, and in the hearing aid industry. So after my private practice days where I saw patients, we fit hearing aids, did some testing for most of the ENTs in the area, and some teaching at Marshall University. Got an opportunity to join the hearing aid industry, worked in for Siemens here in New Jersey, where I live, for a little over 35 years, when it became also Sivantos. And then a few years ago, sort of semi-retired for a lot of reasons, including my dad's health. But started a little consulting company, which now I do work for Hearing Industries Association, for Remote Ear, and for a lot of other new startups and new ventures in the hearing industry, some of which I can't talk about today. So today's topic, however, is the FDA regulations. And we're going to talk about the definitions of those OTC classifications that were in that 200-page document that I didn't send out to all of you so you could read it ahead of time. We're also going to discuss the federal legislative and regulatory issues surrounding these OTC devices and describe a process for OTC acquisition. I think one of the things that's really been somewhat difficult, I'll say, through this whole process here is to make sure that everybody has the correct information about what the rule is and, more importantly, what the rule isn't. what hearing aids are available, where they're available, and how you might go about acquiring OTCs if you are in that category. So those are the broad categories of things that we're going to try to cover today. Again, as you heard, please use the Q&A, I think is what we want them to use for questions. We'll try to get to as many of those as we have time on the end. I'm targeting that we'll have about 35 to 40 or so minutes, maybe a little more, to talk, go through the lecture today, and then have a fairly reasonable amount of time at the end to answer questions that you may have as we go along. So with that, let's get started here. Just by way of overview, and I'm not going to spend a ton of time here, but as many of you know, this has been a long road and a long journey from when this started, even before this first line here in August of 2017. It really started in 2009 with some workshops at NIDCD, moved into all of the FDA, FTC, National Institute of Medicine, etc. But the law was passed in August of 17 and signed in by then President Trump. The rule was delayed primarily due to the pandemic and other factors at FDA, but there was a significant push once we came out of the pandemic to get this the regulations done based on the direction from Congress. And while there wasn't a tremendous amount of direction from Congress, its prime directive was for the FDA to establish this OTC category. And it was up to them to decide how that would work. And you'll hear me say this several times during this talk. The FDA is responsible primarily for the safety and effectiveness or efficacy of medical devices. There was a lot of requests in the comments to the original rule for people to comment on issues other than safety and effectiveness of the device, which is really not within the realm of what the FDA is charged to do. So some of the things that you'll see later on might still be things that may come out in future documents or might be dealt with by other governmental agencies. So the final rule was issued on the 16th. The rule provides for 60 days afterwards that it becomes effective. So that means about a week and a half or so ago, October 17th, officially OTC devices could be sold in the United States to consumers with mild to moderate hearing loss. And I'm going to say perceived because that's the specific wording in the regulations, perceived mild to moderate hearing loss. There's two compliance dates, and we'll talk a little bit more about these in a while. But the first one is for hearing aids that were not legally offered prior to the effective date of the regulation. This means that if a company was not selling prior to October 17th or hadn't received clearance from the FDA, and the FDA clears instruments to go into the market, they don't approve them. So if you see an approval on somebody's website that's inaccurate, they clear them for market. So those devices have 180 days to submit to the FDA, depending on which class of devices they were in, specifically the self-fitting class, and make sure that all of their documents, the labeling, et cetera, is compliant. For those that were legally in the market, they can sell right now those devices using their existing packaging, and you'll hear more about that a little bit more again in a while, but using existing packaging, existing devices, and they have, again, 6 months to update all of their materials, their brochures, et cetera, which we'll cover. So this is the timeline from 2017 through now and really into next spring, when we will see, fully effective OTC regulations with all of the labeling, et cetera, that was required. So let's move on. Key points in terms of the FDA regulations, and when I say key points, primarily from a consumer standpoint, there are a lot of a lot of this document related to things the manufacturers of the devices needed to do. In terms of how big the labeling documents have to be, et cetera. But from what we want to talk about today, which is really from more of a consumer standpoint, I think these are the key things that I'd like other people take away from today. The first is the definitions within the regulations. Again, it is for perceived mild to moderate hearing loss, and that is not defined by a decibel level or a specific range of hearing loss in the FDA regulations, because they felt that individuals should be able to identify the extent of their hearing loss using either some materials that were provided in the document and or materials that would be provided externally, meaning by either manufacturers or other groups that were providing educational materials. So perceived is the key word there. We know from a lot of data that's been collected over the years, most people tend to underestimate their hearing loss. So this is was some area of concern for the regulations, in that if you haven't had a hearing test since the one you had in elementary school down at the nurse's office, raising your hand when you hear the beeps, if you're an adult over 18 and you think you have a hearing loss, it may be time to take further action to get some type of test, and we'll talk about that. As I mentioned, these are for 18 plus, so this is not intended for children to be using these OTC devices. Children need really to be seen by physicians and audiologists currently within the regulations, primarily due to speech and language development, to ensure that they're getting the right educational resources. So again, perceived mild, moderate, over 18. There were three categories of devices that were put into the regulations. OTC, which of course is the broad category, but OTC was really broken into two types of devices, or two classifications. The second one being self-fit OTC, and the third being prescription, which is the devices that are currently in the market today that most of us are familiar with, that are fit by hearing care professionals, whether that's an audiologist or a hearing care specialist. So if you see in the second panel, I just pulled some of the wording from the document. OTC devices themselves enable the users to access or select output characteristics that are most significant to the user's perception of using that device. This could be a series of presets in the device that you access via push button or some other simple way to change the characteristics of the device. It does not indicate that these devices will be customized in any way or self-fit to the extent that it fits to your audiogram. Those devices move into the next category you see in the third panel, called self-fit OTC, not versus, self-fit OTC. These devices incorporate technology, including software, that integrates the user's input with a strategy that actually then becomes or defines a fitting process for that device. This is similar in some ways, but not exactly the same as we see in prescriptive devices, where you may use computer programming to do this. This could be a customization that takes place while you're wearing the device. It could be assisted by an app, or it could be assisted by some online connection for the device to allow customization beyond just simple push buttons. So these are the self-fitting devices. Prescription devices, the last category you see on the right, are primarily the existing class of devices that are sold today by hearing care professionals. These require an audiometric test and professional fitting and follow-up. These devices are regulated currently by the states, and will continue to be regulated by the states under licensing for both audiologists and hearing aid specialists. The FDA regulations as it relates to OTC and self-fit OTC are very specific, that states cannot pass a law that would in some way interfere, which is the key word, interfere with users getting these devices, and also cannot require the intervention or services of a hearing care professional, audiologist, or physician. So these are intended for people to acquire on their own If they're self-fitting, they could, again, be customized, or if those don't seem appropriate, prescription devices are still available. We are not going to talk too much here about other types of specialty devices, cochlear implants, other device like ear lens, which is placed on your ear. There's a lot of specialty devices that are also regulated by the FDA, but we're going to focus primarily on the OTC devices today. So those may be for another seminar. So with that out of the way, what were some of the key consumer protections, or in some ways, because people's thinking with the lack of consumer protections that were issued in the FDA regulations? The first one is it was related to receipts, return privileges or periods, and warranties. The final rule declined to include requirements for receipts, warranties, or minimum return periods or trial periods. The concern among a lot of people in the comments, and as I should mention, there were well over 1,000 comments submitted to the FDA on this regulation. A lot of them were concerned with the fact that there was no mandate, if you will, for a return privilege. The FDA left that primarily to the states because that's comes under consumer protections, as if you were buying another device, a TV or a pair of headphones you're going to wear on a plane, or any other type of device that would come under their consumer purchases, lemon laws, etc. Those should cover OTC devices being in the consumer side. There are specific warranties, return privileges, receipt requirements for prescription devices that flow through either the product itself or the person fitting them, the licensee, audiologist, or hearing care specialist. So in the prescription side, we do have those requirements in place and will continue to be in place. So this is an area that we're going to talk about that you need to be keenly aware of as you begin down the road if you're thinking about an OTC device. Ensuring that you, one, get a receipt, check on the warranty and repair period. So again, as you see here, the FDA deferred to the states to implement these consumer protections as long as they do not restrict or interfere with commercial activity involving OTC hearing aids, meaning, again, they can't pass any specific laws that would in somehow inhibit people, cause them additional barriers, or again, interfere or restrict the commercial access to OTC devices. So these are going to be available. We already see they're available in a lot of places. So first part, again, is to talk about, as you're thinking about these devices, is the labeling requirements, which was a pretty extensive part of the document. And they included both inside the box and outside the box, as they're referred to, labeling. So let's first deal with outside of the box, because that's what you're going to see first when you walk into one of the stores that are going to be handling OTC devices. You'll see the box there on the shelf. It should include marks as OTC and hearing aid. It could say self-fit OTC, but those markings or labeling should be a part of the external box. There are specific warnings and other important information that the FDA required, specifically related to, you see two little lines down, red flags and the advice availability of professional services. Also, symptoms suggested that perceived mild to moderate hearing loss is what you have. So they're giving you some ideas of the kinds of experiences you may have, not hearing well in background noise, not hearing loud sounds as everybody else does. There's a whole list of these that are in the document, as well as should be on the labeling for those devices that will include this labeling. So we have to just remember the two deadlines for compliance, whether these were existing manufacturers or whether they're going to be new manufacturers. The one important thing about return policy, that has to be stated. And if there is not one, that also has to be stated. So if there is not a return privilege, that has to be stated clearly on the outside of the box. Battery information, whether these have replaceable batteries, as a lot of us may be familiar with, with our hearing aids, 10, 13, you know, all the different size batteries, or if it is a rechargeable hearing aid. And there is a charger that probably is in the box, and also instructions on how to use that. And I think that's important because there are some people that maybe don't want to be bothered changing batteries and really like the idea of rechargeable. So it's something that's very important to be on the outside of the box, so you know right away that devices you're looking at, if there's, pick a number, 5 or 10 sitting on a shelf, you can certainly key in on the ones that are rechargeable. Also, whether a mobile device or other non-included platform like a website is needed in order to complete the setup of the device. So in the case that you might need your mobile phone and connect via Bluetooth, or you have to connect your computer so that you can download certain information, that also has to be indicated on the outside of the box. So these are sort of the key things that you'll be looking for. Later on, we're going to come up with a checklist of how you might use these, but these are the things that are really sort of important to look at. Inside the package, instructional brochures inside and an electronic version available. A lot of comments on this as well. The fact that the instructional brochure is inside the box, unless you're going to bust it open in the store, you won't have access to it. One of the other suggestions, if you will, from the FDA is that there be a QR code or some type of scanning possible, so that if you'd like to get access to the instructional brochure before you purchase it, that is something that could be available both inside the package or on the display, let's say in the store. There would be maybe a QR code or a code that you can scan, which would download the instructional materials. There needs to be warnings in regards to age. As I mentioned, these are for over 18. Red flag conditions, such as if you're having pain in your ear, discharge from your ear, pain if you would put the device in. So all of those warnings need to be clearly indicated in the materials you get inside the box. Also cautions about using hearing protection and excessive sound output, complaints about, you know, things getting stuck in your ear, and also reporting adverse events to the FDA. This is a very important part that's both in the prescription as well as the OTC devices. The FDA has established a website for consumers that if they have issues with a device, for example, the little tip or the dome pops off and stays in your ear, and you, maybe that happens a couple times, or you have to receive medical attention for getting one out, that would be considered an adverse event or an adverse effect from wearing the device. And that should be reported to the FDA, who in turn would certainly contact the manufacturer for them to remedy that situation. So all of these, if you will, notices and cautions, especially also with hearing protection, as I mentioned, if you're already experiencing hearing loss, not a good idea if you're an active shooter, let's say, in terms of target practice or hunting or whatever, to be wearing these devices while you're blasting, loud sounds. So for people that should sort of seem to be a normal course of things, all of those warnings are in there. There should be illustrations and diagrams of the controls, the battery compartment, how all those things work. Instructions on how the tools work, the test, the software, how to keep it working, maintenance, how to change the battery and or recharge it, how you get repair, how you get replacements if your device becomes defective under the warranty. And also if there are any performance studies, this is especially true in the self-fit category, where the manufacturer has to submit to the FDA some clinical data showing the efficacy of the self-fitting procedure, that it actually can be done by the individuals and it actually results in a fit that's reasonable for a particular audiogram. So all of these are things that need to be inside the package. There are a couple of things you need to look for on the device, and if you don't see them, it's certainly an area of concern. First is the serial number. This is your way and the manufacturer's way, and also the FDA. That's the way they track individual devices. The serial number should be legible. Either it's engraved on the outside of the device, In some cases, it's on a small tag or something inside the battery compartment. There should be markings where the battery is plus or minus, and also importantly, whether the unit is used or rebuilt. This has to be clearly identified. It doesn't have to be etched into the device, but there should be a tag or label attached to the device to indicate if that is a rebuilt device. It is not illegal to sell a rebuilt device. It does have, however, need to be specified so that if you do buy a device and it's marketed and sold as new and you find a marking on it that says it's rebuilt, clearly you need to contact the manufacturer. But again, this is something that is kind of important to ensure that you're getting a new device. The software device labeling is probably not that important from a consumer standpoint, although knowing which software is being used is important. Also, we're beginning to see that there might be fees and or payments, I call them subscriptions, for certain hearing devices. We're beginning to see where you can pay a certain number of dollars per month, which includes services as well as sort of like leasing your car. At the end of 3 years, you turn those instruments back in and you get new instruments and you continue paying a subscription fee. If that's the case for the device that you happen to purchase, that has to be identified, and you need to know that from the labeling. The technical specifications, for those of you that are into the technical specifications of prescriptive devices, you may notice that these are different than prescriptive devices. The FDA mandated a very a different set of technical requirements for OTC devices that better allow consumers to compare the devices. The current technical specifications, or the ANSI requirement, if you will, is used by manufacturers primarily as a quality control device for devices to maintain quality control. It sets tolerances. It tells you what the maximum output should be, what the maximum gain should be, what the maximum distortion should be. And any device that leaves their factory cannot exceed those specifications. It doesn't, however, talk about the specific device and how that device has been manufactured, especially for things you see here on the bottom, when upper and lower cutoff frequencies for bandwidth. All of these are standard measures that should be included either outside the package or in the user instruction brochure that's included with the device. So if you're wondering what the output is, what the gain is, what the distortion is, the self-generated noise level, this is the noise that's generated by the microphones that most people can't hear. But if you have good low frequency hearing and your hearing loss is mostly in the high frequencies, you might hear a slight hiss or buzz, which is usually referred to as the self-generated noise. And also something called the latency value, which is how long it takes the signal to move through the hearing aid. In most devices, this is less than 10 milliseconds, which most people can't really hear, but it's the time from it enters the microphone till it exits the loudspeaker in your ear canal. If that latency becomes too long, what you end up with is, it could be almost like an echo. Or we also refer to it as delayed auditory feedback. It's listening to your own voice with a 1 or 2 second delay, which sounds very, very weird. Also, since most of these devices won't fit really snugly in your ear, so we're talking about mild to moderate hearing loss, what you could end up with is the amplified sound coming through at a slight delay than the external sound. So if someone is speaking to you, that's going to enter your ear canal sort of around the little dome or tip that's in your ear and go directly to your eardrum, where the sound that's going through your device is going to take a little bit longer. And if that delay becomes too long, you're going to notice that difference in that latency will become somewhat critical in terms of your ability to understand speech, especially. So latency values are an important measure here and are included in the measurements that need to be displayed on the package or in the owner's manual. So if you see something I don't think anyone would try to market one with 30 or 40 milliseconds, but if you do, that's just way too long. So that's something I'm sure that, people will be a lot more information coming out about that. Just again, a summary of labeling. Again, the requirements are effect for all devices, effective 17th of October. So all the devices have these. If your current sell devices is currently selling devices, you can consider, you can continue to sell those using your current labeling or packaging until March of 2023. So for those devices, you may see, I've already seen a couple of videos of the unpacking of the device, and the new labeling is not on those devices that have been in the market so far. Those manufacturers are currently updating those, printing new instruction manuals, printing new outside boxes, printing all the new stuff. And sometime before March of 23, we'll probably integrate all that new material into devices that are sold. So again, you may or may not see all the required labeling, especially if it has a return privilege. So you'll need to really take a look at probably the display where these devices are to indicate whether or not there's a return. If you're not clear and it's a device you think you want to purchase, certainly ask the seller of the device if they're offering a return privilege on that device. Some of these labeling requirements do not apply at the current time for online retailers, so you may not see that online, but most of them will include this material either right now if they have it available, and there are a couple of devices that have it, but certainly no later than March of 23. Ensure that you can get a refund for any device that you purchase. This is something that, that everybody felt fairly strongly about, that there should be this consumer protection. It makes no sense for someone to spend a few hundred to $1,000 on devices and then find out that they don't work for them and are unable to return those to the seller. That just delays everyone's interest in helping themselves through getting hearing aids to be able to interact with their family, friends, etc. So this is an important part of the OTC, is to really ensure that if you buy a device, that it does allow you to bring it back if it doesn't provide benefit to you. So the landscape has changed since OTC law was passed, and we've now have the regulations. As many of you may be aware, Medicare has been introduced into multiple Congresses, not only the past 5 years, but probably I think over the last 15 or 20, we've seen to try and expand the scope of Medicare, not only for hearing services, but also vision and dental, which were excluded in the original Medicare legislation. We do see a real increase in Medicare Advantage enrollment. It's expected to be over 50% of Medicare population by next year are enrolled in some type of Medicare Advantage program. And at last estimate by some external companies that track this, 98% of enrollees have access to hearing exams and or hearing aids. So the vast majority of Medicare Advantage programs do offer some services in terms of hearing aids and hearing testing. The utilization is fairly low. I've seen estimates from, 10 to 30 or 40%. That's not quite tracked as much as the enrollees, but it's increasing significantly. So Medicare Advantage is becoming a place for people to get those services. CellFit devices came in 2017 with Bose. They were the first ones. They now have joined a partnership with Lexi and are sort of co-marketing, co-branding the Bose Lexi devices. Several other companies have also joined the CellFit category by submitting to the FDA and receiving clearance. Direct-to-consumer is something that was coined because OTC didn't exist and we were selling devices directly to consumers through websites, internet, etc. And a lot of these operated sort of with, I'll say, just approval, but no enforcement from the FDA unless they violated, of course, any of the regulations. These are pretty much going to be going away because they now must move into the OTC or CellFit OTC categories because we now have regulations and these are now regulated medical devices. So we will see almost all of these. You see a few on the bottom there. You could read the list. There may be others. I just picked a few names. But these all will be the new OTC devices, both self-fit as well as standard OTC. Pharmacists are continue to expand. This is a very interesting part of OTC. Continue to expand their not only education and training in pharmacy school, but also training after they all are out working. Pharmacists provide, as you see, I mean, as we know, vaccines for COVID, shingles, and many other primary care features. An interesting fact that I saw about a month or two ago from the drugstore news is that 90% of Americans live within 5 miles of one of the 60,000 community pharmacies nationwide. There are two large pharmacy chains that have announced that they are going to be operating and selling and providing OTC devices within their stores. The University of Pittsburgh has worked with the Pharmacy Association to develop an online, I think it's a 10 or 15 hour training course for pharmacists so they can better understand some of the basics of hearing loss, when to refer, what some of the red flags are. I don't think they're going to be involved in fitting as much as they are providing assistance and recommendation for patients that may come in and just ask questions, much like they might have about which OTC device is best for my allergies. They're not physicians, but pharmacists are playing a greater and more important role in primary care as we move into a sort of brand new health system. So given that as the background, what should you do before you purchase an OTC, or you're at least thinking about one? I wouldn't be a good audiologist if I didn't tell you to go get a hearing test. I think because the regulations specify the perceived mild to moderate category, it's very difficult for individuals to know how severe their hearing loss is. And as I mentioned earlier, most people underestimate. Usually family, friends, or the early ones, colleagues at work, to tell you that you're repeating a lot. At home, they may tell you the TV's loud. I know when I was seeing patients, most of them felt that everybody else was just mumbling. So it always was one of those no, it's you discussions. But in order to find out for sure if you're going to be able to benefit from an OTC or a self-fit OTC device, you need to understand what your hearing loss is, not only from the severity, but also potentially the shape. Not all hearing losses are the same. Some have a lot, or are flat. Some have much more high frequency emphasis. There are some that are actually in the reverse, meaning mostly low frequency hearing loss and good in the highs. So if you've seen one audiogram, you've seen one audiogram. And it's important to know where you fall within this range, because if you really are at the upper limits of the moderate category, not all of these devices are going to be appropriate for you. And I'm not sure it's a great, great strategy to try one, send it back, and spend a lot of time. I would encourage people to sort of have a more focused approach on what kind of device, and we'll come to a checklist, but what kind of device you may think is appropriate for you, and try that one and really try it. Many offices, clinics, hearing aid specialists offer free tests, so you might be able to get a free test. You may have to pay. Insurances in general don't pay for hearing tests that are related to the potential fitting of a hearing aid. Those are excluded. So if you go in and say, I want to get a hearing test because I want to get a hearing aid, bells go off in most people's heads saying, well, that's great, we can do that, but your insurance probably isn't going to pay for it. There are some online tests that some of the manufacturers have put online, and other associations have online, that give you at least some indication if you're in the mild to moderate category, how much difficulty you might have in background noise. There is a paper sort of assessment called the CEDRA. You see here, Consumer Ear Disease Risk Assessment is what that stands for. That's available. And if you search CEDRA, You'll come up with the actual questionnaire. It asks you a whole bunch of questions about where you have difficulty, et cetera. And you give them a certain number of points and you add up the points. And based on the points, it tells you whether you're at risk for ear disease, in essence, hearing loss, and what the severity potentially of that might be. So another indicator of how much hearing loss you may have. I encourage you to make a list of the places or environments that you have difficulty, and you may want to do this with other family, spouse, friends, colleagues, significant other. Where are you having difficulty? This may help you when we begin to think about the type of device, the style of device, and the features of the device that you might need and really should have in the device if it's going to provide you significant benefit. So is it when you're, most people hear fairly well and quiet, even with mild to moderate hearing loss, maybe when you're in restaurants, maybe when you're at meetings at work, there's a whole bunch of environments where you should probably be aware. It's not an easy thing to accept that you have to get to that level, but I think it's an important step. Also, what style is right for you? Would you prefer one that fits behind your ear? There's receiver in the canal, there's customs, there's a variety of styles. I'm sure if you've been out on the internet and done any searching, you've seen there's a whole bunch of them, even some that look like earbuds or hearables, as they're sometimes called. So a lot of different styles. So have a moment to think about that. What features are necessary or important to you? T-coils, I list here first because usually they're one of the forgotten features. T-coils have become fairly important for people in classrooms, churches, public buildings, civic halls, theaters, the list goes on. T-coils work by having a loop, typically, in a big room. That's one application. In a large room, when you switch your device, usually with a push button or a switch, to T-coil mode, you're able to pick up from this loop in the room, pick up the signal. So, for example, in a church or synagogue, place of worship, it's connected to the public address system, to the speakers, but you don't use the speaker. It's basically sent directly into your hearing aid. We have hundreds of places in the U.S. with loops. And as we are waiting, Bluetooth, which we'll come to in a second, T-coils have become an important way for people to hear in those environments. Rechargeable batteries, I mentioned earlier, is that for you? Would you say, maybe that's not for me because I'd forget to put it in the charger. I'd rather just change batteries. That's a decision you have to make. Bluetooth streaming, if it's important to you that your hearing aids hook to your phone, that you can take phone calls. We have a new system that probably will be coming in the near future, Oralcast, which will allow Bluetooth from one to many, as it's referred to. So, for example, if there's a Bluetooth TV in the waiting area of a gate at an airport, as long as you connect to that Bluetooth signal, everybody there can listen. Right now, Bluetooth is sort of a one-to-one connection. A lot of recommendations that until that happens, of course, depending on where you go, you may need both Bluetooth as well as a T-coil. FM systems we see more for children, but there are people who use those. Infrared systems are available. We see those a lot in theaters that don't have loops or as an adjunct to loops. Infrared doesn't go through the walls, so you only can listen within the theater, for example, and you couldn't be outside with an FM receiver picking up the latest Broadway show, recording it, and then selling CDs to people as they exit the theater. That doesn't work with infrared. Also, what kind of support do you want or do you need from your OTC device and or your OTC manufacturer? Is it enough that you would have an app that you download and that provides information, additional information, ways to adjust and potentially customize your device? Live phone support, do you want online support? You need to think about that because those devices are going to have different ways of supporting them. Where to get them? Hearing care professionals. If you go there, many of them have started and or will start to have both OTC and prescriptive devices. If you are going to go there, I would encourage you to ask, especially if you really are interested in an OTC device, ensure that they're actually carrying them, and you can go and inquire, get a test, and then have a discussion about OTC devices with the hearing care professional. Retail stores, several models, several price points. We've seen a number of them already indicate that they're going to be selling them, Best Buy and a bunch of others. Pharmacies, we've seen two pharmacy chains, and I'm sure there'll be more that are going to be selling some OTC devices in their stores. They don't all have them as of yet. If you think of the big chains that have 10 or 15,000 stores in the country, it's going to be a while before they all have them. I can tell you out here in the northeast rural part of New Jersey, the local pharmacy I go to hasn't got them yet. I've been checking, but neither of the two pharmacies that have launched so far haven't indicated that that they're in this part of the country yet. If you're looking online, be sure that you're looking at OTC or self-fit OTC models, not PSAPs or hearables. PSAPs especially have a separate guidance document from the FDA. They use the word not intended, the not intended use. Those devices are for people with normal hearing that want to hear birds, that want to go in the woods and go on hikes, etc., and want to have a better hearing. Maybe you want to hear better at bridge club, and but they're not intended and shouldn't be marketed for people with hearing loss. That's a violation of the current FDA regulations, and so those would be subject to enforcement by either FDA or potentially the Federal Trade Commission. How to get them? Again, start your checklist. Where are you going to start? Know your hearing loss when you go there, whether that's online or pharmacy, all the places we've outlined so far. Keep your list of styles and features handy while you're searching. If you need directional microphone, feedback reduction, all of the features that we're beginning to see, not only in prescriptive devices, but in many of these OTC devices as well. As you move up the hearing loss from mild to the upper ends of moderate, feedback reduction could be more important than if you're in the mild category. Be sure to verify the return privilege. Establish your budget for a pair of devices. We're seeing devices currently sold already for $200 or $300 a pair at the low end, and up through including $2,500, $900 for a pair at the very high end in OTCs, which of course is very similar to the prescriptive devices. We see it even in prescription side, they range from $1,500 a pair to $4,000 or $5,000. It's somewhat uncommon to find them, as we see in the media these days, for $10,000 or $15,000. I think that's a bit of a stretch. But again, prescriptive devices, we have to remember, are not only the devices, but also the testing, fitting, and follow-up services of the professional, which includes their overhead for keeping their office open. Check the company reviews. This is sort of an important part too. We're going to have new companies coming in, and you may not recognize their names. Yes, there are some recognizable consumer brands that have already started, but see if they have reviews on their website. See how long they've been in business, if they have a better business review. Again, you don't want to purchase a device, find out 2 months from now they're sort of out of business, and now you're not sure how you can get it replaced if it becomes defective, etc. So, you know, as always, consumer beware is with everything, but here especially is check the reviews and see who those companies are. So did OTC solve the issue it was intended for? Two of them, access and affordability. Access, I would say yes. We've already seen retail establishments beginning to offer these. The increase in rural or remote areas, I think, is one benefit that we will see from OTCs. We've heard this. I coined hearing aid deserts. Actually, a friend of mine, Anthony Joseph at University of Minnesota, refers to them as audiology and hearing aid deserts. We've seen them for grocery store deserts, etc. But there may not be an audiologist or a dispenser in most small cities around the country. But there certainly, as you saw earlier, there is a pharmacy. Has it solved affordability? Yes. We see devices from $250 to $2,900 are now available. My guess is that high-end one will begin to come down as competition drives prices there. We'll also see probably some impact in the prescriptive side where there may be some separation of the devices and the services, which will allow a little more transparency in terms of the overall cost of the devices. Were there unintended consequences? Yes, I think there are some, a lot of confusion for consumers. We've tried to help point out some of the areas of confusion, looking for warranty, making sure that you get the kind of device with the kind of features. There were some unresolved state licensing issues. The FDA has issued an update now, which indicates that, that prescriptive devices can be, quote, prescribed by those that are licensed, audiologists, hearing aid specialists. There was some concern that use of that word would reinstitute the fact that everyone would have to go see a physician and get the device prescribed. The FDA has clarified that, so I think we're out of the woods there. The lack of public awareness and education on OTC and the process, I think, is one that, again, would have been great if the FDA did that. But as we've said a number of times, their job is to look at the safety of the devices. You know, a number of organizations have come together on this little graphic you see here for Hear Well campaign, which is a series of informational videos and lots of information at hearing.org. On OTC devices, how you approach them, some of what we've talked about today, to try and get the information out to consumers about what these devices are about, how to get them, and how to make sure that they continue to work for you and provide benefit. So these are both audiology groups, HLAA, the industry groups. It cuts across the entire spectrum of people who are associated with hearing and hearing loss. So which one's right for you? That's your decision. I wish I could tell you that. You see here just some examples. I mean, we have what looks like a sort of a hearable or an earbud, a sort of a BTE or a RIC, and sort of custom devices as well. This is one of the choices of styles. And so with that, I think we'll end here and say, I hope that we provided a little bit of insight into not only the regulation, but how that regulation may work for you if you're looking for OTC devices and get a process that will help you be successful in getting one of these devices. So with that, I'll end the official part here and we'll go to some questions, which I think will be queued up. I think I see 20 in there, but some of them may be similar. So we'll start with those. Do I need to look at those? Let me see.
No,
you're going to do that. Okay, good. So you've been looking.
I have.
Okay, so good.
Our first question is, what kind of safeguards have been or being put into place to protect consumers from misleading marketing that will take advantage of them in one of their most vulnerable times of their life as they come to terms with the fact that they may have a hearing loss?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think the FDA has an enforcement wing, if you will. If any consumer or anyone actually can report to the FDA not only the adverse effects we talked about earlier, but if they see marketing that is inappropriate. The other aspect of this is I can tell you that as an audiologist that belongs to all of the major audiology organizations, we all watch these all the time and are very active in reporting these both to the FDA. And I mentioned the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, is also has been very active and has issued some warnings and some fines to people for misleading advertising. There really are no safeguards, if you will, in place yet, because this regulation primarily dealt with those two things, the access to affordability and the technical specifications. So anyone who identifies rogue people or bad actors, whichever we want to refer to them as, those should be referred both to the FDA and to the Federal Trade Commission. Both of them have places on their website for reporting those kinds of things. Certainly Better Business Bureau and other of the normal kinds of ones. But as it relates to this, those two organizations are important. Also, I'm sure within HLAA, government affairs folks are also looking at these, and you could certainly ask for their help in reporting them.
Absolutely. The next question is, someone is concerned that the OTC may backfire, and will advertising encourage consumers to seek audiology tests before going out to buy OTCs?
Yeah, it could be. You know, I think there's no, you know, there's no requirement. I mean, and specifically, I mean, the regulations say you cannot require a test to get one. So I think, you know, it sort of goes to good health practices, you know, to try and figure out where your hearing loss is. I know a lot of people love to make this analogy with eyeglasses, but I really hate it. But because they're two totally different systems, our vision is a very simple system in the sense that we're sort of bending the light to go into our eyes with a pair of readers, and all of a sudden you can see things in front of you. It's not quite that easy for the auditory system, but you can go and you know, go to the pharmacy and stand at that little counter and zip them around and pick one up and put it on and look in the mirror to make sure you look cool, and also read the little chart to make sure that you can see. I'd love for it to be that easy for us to do, you know, with hearing. But I think having a test done can give you a lot of information. I do hope that we don't see people using this in an inappropriate way. I'll put it that way, that you know, audiologists and hearing aid specialists continue to offer the services that they do at reasonable prices or at no charge for people, so they can understand, are these devices appropriate for them?
Okay. Someone else asked, what capabilities does a prescription hearing aid have that the OTC hearing aids cannot have or don't have?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that I've noticed, and that's why I've sort of spent a little bit of time on the T-coils, is as of right now, I've only seen one, and somebody mentioned one the other day. So one or two of the OTCs that are out that actually have T-coils in them. So if you're somebody who really needs a T-coil, or you know, let's say goes to theaters or you know, community buildings, etc., OTCs may not be for you, and you may have difficulty finding one. On the prescription side, most of those devices either can be have a T-coil integrated, or can be added. I mean, there's a couple of manufacturers that have special battery compartments that have a T-coil in them. I think beyond that, it's really about the fitting of the device, I would say, more specifically to your audiogram, because you're going to have a hearing test in the prescription side. You're going to then have some software that will actually, your audiogram will be entered into that fitting software. The device will be pre-programmed by that fitting software. And then the professional will do some tests to decide if your the output in your ear matches that. It's called real ear or probe microphone measures, and then make adjustments to ensure that you are getting the most benefit from those devices and can continue to make those adjustments. The OTCs will have some of that, but not nearly to the sophistication of the prescriptive devices. That doesn't mean, if you're in the mild to moderate category, that you would necessarily need that. Many people I refer to as situational wearers, meaning, you know, I do okay in quiet, but when I go to dinner, when the grandkids come over, when I'm in a meeting, whatever, those situations, which is why they're situational wearers, are places that I'll wear them. And when I get home, I'm going to take them off. So, you know, it may be that for those individuals, OTC devices can be very appropriate to help them in those environments that they're having difficulty with, which in 5 or 10 years may be everywhere. But for right now, that device may be appropriate.
Okay. We're coming to the end of our hour. There were still a variety of questions that were put in.
I can stay for a few more minutes. It's up to you guys.
Okay. Well, what I was going to say is, if folks still have questions, can they reach out to you directly as well with their questions?
Sure. You see, the admin here at hearing.org, since this was sort of part of our, hearing.org, which is the Hearing Industries Association of Better Hearing. But my email, direct email, is Dr. like Dr. Tom Powers at comcast.net. So Dr. Tom Powers info@comcast.net. I'm happy to take, you know, some questions from individuals, or we can try to, the ones that are in here, certainly if we can get those into a document, I'm happy to have one of you send those over and we could answer them and send them out to participants. However, this would work best for you.
That would work as well too, I think. So we can do that too.
So we can,
Great. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Powers. Someone put into the Q&A, this isn't really a Q&A, but they think you're fabulous and this has been wonderful. And thank you, Tony, our captioner. We really appreciate it.
Sorry. Hopefully I wasn't too fast for you, Tony. Sorry. That's my New York bringing up.
So hopefully folks enjoyed this. It will be available on our website in about a week or two. And thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Thanks. Have a great day, everybody.